Yeah, that's actually very common to the energy efficiency debate. It's the same issue where you have agency issues and extremely high implied discount rates for private investment and that prevent investments. And some solutions have been found in the energy efficiency space, like energy service companies.
And the same thing in agriculture. I mean, you can think about it. As I said, the data shows that some of these practices do appear beneficial and even more profitable in the long run. Now, the question is, what kind of incentives you put in place, even if they're present for a limited amount of time, but how do you create those incentives in a way that you can make that transition? And that is difficult, given that particularly when you talk about smallholder farming, you know, you're thinking about sort of this year and next year. That's about it.
Very good. We do have time for another round of questions, and I see many, many hands. So why don't we actually go towards the back of the room that hasn't been touched too much. The lady in the back there, your hand up. Yep.
Thank you. My name is Robin from the University of Sydney. My question is, what role do you see for anthropologists and ecologists in this work? I worry that those of us from a physical science background are not trained to see systems in terms of people, climate change. It's about us in terms of adapting to climate change. It's also about us. And we have an uneven track record in terms of what farmers have seen that we've recommended and then we've changed our minds about. So ecologists, because of the landscape approach, maybe they also have a role. So that's my question. What role do you see
what
for
anthropologists
and ecologists? Thank you.
And ecologists. Over there in the back, yes.
Solomon Asfo from FAO. I'd like to second what the gentleman said about the problem with the adoption of climate smart agriculture, that the upfront cost is pretty high and farmers don't have incentive to adopt and the benefits come in the long term. And we in FAO do a lot of activities on climate smart agriculture, and we just agree with what you came up with that. So we figure out some of the barriers at the institutional level, at the ground level and the policy level, and trying to design an investment proposal that could address those barriers so that the farmers could have an incentive to adopt those products. But my question is with the definitions of the climate smart. I would like to know your view. Do you consider like diversification to different livelihood options as climate smart agriculture? The use of fertilizer, you cannot imagine African farmers growing a crop without using an organic fertilizer. Would that be, you could compare that with conservation agriculture in terms of getting a yield. So efficient use of fertilizer and so forth, that would make a very big difference. And what is your take on that? Another one point I'd like to make.
Sorry, one question. Okay. So fertilizer, what use of fertilizer, anthropologists. One more question. The gentleman over there has had his hands up several times. So, yeah.
Thank you. Danish Dinesh from CCAFS. Just from all these speakers, we've heard about different approaches. We heard about climate smart agriculture, sustainable land management, ecosystem-based adaptation, biodiversity in agricultural crops, and tree species on farms, and so on. So there are a varied range of approaches here. So when we consider development programming, is it possible to achieve synergies between these approaches? Is it possible to integrate these approaches, or should we not do that? So just want to know, in terms of implementation at the country level or the international level, how do we integrate these approaches? Thank you.
Okay, very good. So there's, who wants to take the anthropology question? Let's do one question per panelist. Yeah, Robert.
I'll take this one because it's something that comes on every day in C4. Well, in fact, we are a forestry research organization, but I mean, we have two or three foresters only, one of them. I guess that anthropologists and ecologists, they have a huge role to play if they play together. I wouldn't say that I'm going to answer the fertilization one, saying that they should fertilize each other, but that's the point. I mean, so that we are going to bring some preliminary answer or some temporary answer of this very complex problem, only if we tackle them based on the multidisciplinary or interdisciplinary approach. So that's why we insist very much in the fact that you cannot solve it only looking at the ecological part, only looking at the anthropological part, only looking at the economic part, but you are not going to solve them if you forget one of these elements. So I guess, yes, they have a big role to play, but we are all asked to go out of our comfort zone, put aside our small turf wars, and work together.
Okay, so we need to break silos, except for those who actually contain grain. Okay, Alex, do you want to take the question on fertilizing?
So the question actually was also about the definition, which is extremely important. So this definition of climate smart agriculture, first of all, is still developing. So I'm not sure that, what is important is that we talk about it. My personal opinion is that you need to set those boundaries clearly, even though probably we will exclude some type of farming. So if we make it a definition such that everything fits into it, it will be an empty box at the end. And so we have to define the boundaries, and we need to do a lot of work on the trade-offs, which is still missing. And that will allow us to sort of to say more. Because, for instance, you know, one of the biggest problems with climate smart agriculture is to define climate dumb agriculture. Because we all have in mind some dumb example, right? Okay, that we all sort of can give those examples, but the problem is, okay, what happens when you have a transformation in the system for which it delivers more on two sort of dimensions, but it delivers less on another one? Where is that trade-off, and where is acceptable? How do we rank these things? We're really far from that. And so we need work in that sense. And in terms of the sustainable intensification, kind of sort of, if I understand your question, you know, all the results that I obtained, those are strict mitigation, so reduction of emissions, okay? If you try, I haven't tried yet, but I will, if you try to do reduction of emission intensity, for sure you're going to get completely different results. And no-till would not be one of the superior practices, because it isn't.
Okay, so we have 5 minutes left. So I would say, Alisher, Richard, and Anne, 1 minute each to talk about the synergies. So what are the synergies between these different responses to resilience that we have discussed? Anne, do you want to start?
Well, I was going to actually take the synergies issue in a different direction. And back to the question about how do you convince finance ministers. We talked about this a little bit yesterday in the nutrition section. A lot of the concepts we've been recommending here, first of all, are very consistent. We may call them different things. I mean, the ecological approach is very, you know, there's a lot of biodiversity in that approach. So I think we're probably less different than the words we're using, first of all. But I think that a lot of these approaches can achieve multiple objectives. And that's where we need to pull together to convince the finance ministers to put money into the objective, into the measures, into the policies that can achieve more than one societal objective. Thanks.
Richard. Yeah, thank you very much. I agree with Anne. I think, as she said, I mean, most of these approaches are actually doing the same thing. I mean, the nomenclature or the different names most of the time sounds as if they are doing different things. But however, harnessing and bringing all of them together will bring more value addition and at the same time also ensure cost effectiveness, especially in the context of resilience building. So how to do that is a challenge because of most of the time we know the difficulty, especially when different organizations are operating in different comfort zones and at the same time having different mandates. But I think working together under a common vision of achieving climate resilience and at the same time food security will add more value and also ensure cost effectiveness, which I think it should be the next step in looking how that can be done under the context of the changing climate.
Alisha, do you want to add something?
We can actually relate these two questions about role of anthropology, psychologists, and also integrating all the different perspectives we had here. Of course, there is a need for integration. Every discipline has its sheds insights from its own angle, but once we have all the different angles, we have a better understanding of the picture. So there is a need for some kind of nexus thinking when we can bring together different sectors, different disciplines, and also include people through transdisciplinary approaches. Because investments into those areas which have this kind of overlaps are likely to yield the highest returns.
Thank you, Alisher. And Richard, you were asking to have.
Yes, I think on the question on how should preparation be and what should really be the way forward, I think community ownership and ownership of everybody in any action that happens is very, very essential. And cost effectiveness of the action that have got to be taken forward. And enabling participation of everyone to be part and parcel of building resilience and ensuring food security is the first step towards ensuring that these resilient aspects can actually be achieved.
Thank you. Before we all give a hand to our panelists to thank them for a very informative and interactive session. Oh, one more thing.
Point. I wanted to link something that Earthrun Cousin said last night when she asked how many farmers were in the room. And link it to the conversation we were having earlier about, you know, it matters where you put the emphasis. And we're treating this like it's an intellectual problem, but we should ask the farmers what they think is important. And I think this is one of the things we're doing with the Seeds for Needs program. We're actually asking the farmers what traits, what goals they think are important that they're trying to achieve. And I think we ignore that aspect of our work far too much. Thanks.
Thank you very much. That was a very good reminder of what should be at the center of this discussion. Thank you so much for this session. Maybe I won't summarize it now. I won't try to do that because we will actually do that in the plenary this afternoon. But one thought that I want to leave you with is this issue of trade-offs and valuing resilience and how we build it. And there is a very good example from outside agriculture. During the tsunami in Japan, there was a huge disruption of supply chains for the automotive industry. You know that Toyota had pioneered the just-in-time system, and so these supply chains were extremely brittle to an interruption of the supply chain. But it's an open question, and probably the answer would be that it was worth it, that actually getting 30 years of saving on supply chain is worth to have 4 weeks of disruption once. And I think when we try to build resilience through things that have cost, like adding either a redundancy or alternative and so on, we ought to ask ourselves really what the value is. And I think that goes beyond just we have the stress testing, but also I think we have the valuing of the measure as a critical step. Now please join me in thanking our panelists for their great contribution.